two young people who had not long been married were walking up and down the platform of a little country station. His arm was around her waist. Her head was almost on his shoulder, and both were happy. The moon peeped up from the drifting cloudlets and frowned, as it seemed, envying their happiness and rejecting her tedious and utterly superfluous virginity. The still air was heavy with the fragrance of lilac and wild cherry. Somewhere in the distance beyond the line, a corncrank was calling. "How beautiful it is, Sasha. How beautiful," murmured the young wife. "It all seems like a dream. See how sweet and inviting that little copse looks. How nice those solid, silent telegraph posts are. They add a special note to the landscape, suggesting humanity, civilization in the distance. Don't you think it's lovely when the wind brings the rushing sound of a train?" "Yes, but what hot little hands you have got." "That's because you are excited, warrior. What have you got for our supper tonight?" "Chicken and salad." "It's a chicken just big enough for two. Then there is the salmon and sardines that were sent from town." The moon, as though she had taken a pinch of snuff, hid her face behind her clothes. Human happiness reminded her of her own loneliness, of her solitary couch beyond the hills and dales. "The train is coming," said the warrior. "How jolly." Three eyes of fire could be seen in the distance. The station master came out on the platform. Signal lights flashed here and there on the line. "Let's see the train in and go home," said Sasha. "What a splendid time we are having together, Maria. It's so splendid and one can hardly believe it's true." The dark monster crept noiselessly alongside the platform and came to a standstill. They caught glimpses of sleepy faces, of heads and shoulders at the dimly lighted windows. "Look, look," they heard from one of the carriages. "Varya and Sasha have come to meet us. There they are. Varya, Varya, look." Two little girls skipped out of the train and hung on Varya's neck. They were followed by a stout, middle-aged lady and a tall, lanky gentleman with gray whiskers. Behind them came two schoolboys, laden with bags. After the schoolboys, the governess, after the governess, the grandmother. Here we are. Here we are, dear boy. Began the whiskered gentleman, excusing Sasha's scent. Sick of waiting for us, I expect. You have been pinching into your old uncle for not coming down all this time, I dare say. Kolya, Kotsya, Nina, Fifa, children, kiss your cousin Sasha. We are all here, the whole troop of us, just for 3 or 4 days. I hope we shan't be too many for you. You mustn't let us put you out. At the sight of their uncle and his family, the young couple were horror-stricken. While his uncle talked and kissed them, Sasha had a vision of their little cottage. He and Varya giving up their three little rooms, all the pillows and bedding to their guests. The salmon, the sardines, the chicken, all devoured in a single instant. The cousins plucking the flowers in their little garden, spilling the ink, filled the cottage with noise and confusion. His aunt talking continually about her ailments and her papa's having been Baron von Windsfintech. And Sasha looked almost with hatred at his young wife and whispered, "It's you they've come to see. Damn them." "No, it's you," answered Varya, pale with anger. They are your relations. They are not mine." And turning to her visitors, she said with a smile of welcome, "Welcome to the cottage." The moon came out again. She seemed to smile, as though she were glad she had no relations. Sasha, turning his head away to hide his angry, despairing face, struggled to give a note of cordial welcome to his voice as he said, "It is jolly of you. Welcome to the cottage."